Hello, I'm Patrick Scott. Welcome back to PLS 101, American Democracy and Citizenship. Today we're going to be talking about campaigns and elections. We'll be covering various things about campaigns, such as campaign finance, problems with our campaign finance system. We'll be talking about different kinds of elections, primaries, the different kinds of primaries. And we'll finish up with a discussion of the Electoral College. What is it? What's good about it? What might need to be changed about it? And those will be some of the topics that we'll be talking about today. So, as an extension of yesterday, we're talking about political parties. One of the prime roles of parties is to help get their candidates elected. Now, campaigning today is obviously very big business. It's a very expensive kind of enterprise. It has radically changed over the past 30, 40 years. Campaigning today has become much more technological, much more sophisticated, and it's become also much more professionalized over the years. And obviously, it's become much more expensive in part because of the rising cost of TV advertisements. You think about this versus years ago, presidential campaigns used to be done by train, where the candidates would go from one station stop to the next station stop, and there'd be a crowd of people who would turn out to hear the candidate make a speech. These were called stump speeches, or stumping on the campaign trail. And campaigns used to be coordinated very strongly by political parties when we had a stronger party system. But today, we have shifted away from party-centered campaigns more to candidate-centered campaigns. And so what that basically means now is that campaigns are not run by parties as much, but instead by the candidate and his or her personal followers and staff. And so with the advent of television and other advances in technology, campaign has really become a science in, or an art in image making. Some of the ways in which you see candidates today taking advantage of new technologies is certainly using internet websites to raise money. I mean, that's particularly a phenomenal change we've seen over the last 3 or 4 years. But also getting on talk radio or getting on Larry King Live, getting some free airtime is always a way to save some money. Instead of taking trains from one point to another, candidates are now flying by jet from city to city. So in a given day, a candidate may hit 4 or 5 cities and cover a lot of the country back and forth. Certainly you want to get on the evening news as much as you can. Sometimes your staff will notify the local TV stations about your arrival at an airport coming up, and the TV stations will come out and give you free media coverage. And the key here is to be able to get on the evening's news by having your campaign stop soon enough to get the coverage, get the footage, and then get on the evening news. So taking advantage of all the free media you can is certainly to your advantage. Okay, so basically then what we're talking about is today the candidates relying upon professionals, media teams, a press secretary. Their job is to get you recognized. You have speech writers, regional and state coordinators to help you, people who are involved in the planning of your appearances from location to location. You may also have people that you hire excuse me, to work on various polls, to conduct polls on your behalf, to tell you how you're doing versus your opponent. They may also have polls to conduct to say, find out what particular segments of society tend to support you the most. And so polling and media consultants will also tell you what kinds of things play well with voters, what kinds of things should you say. And so really interestingly, they'll tell you, for example, to use a lot of buzzwords like family values and responsibility. These are the kinds of things that play well with voters. They may even help you in terms of when you're giving a presentation or giving a campaign speech. They'll tell you, for example, in terms of how you should appear and what little things you should do. And I'm reminding of that because I think about when Bill Clinton was campaigning for the presidency, he often used his thumb to make a point. And the reason why he was doing that in part was because some of his consultants were saying, you know, John F. Kennedy did that quite a bit when he was on the campaign trail. So the way you might be able to look more Kennedy-esque is by using that thumb. So again, little things like that you can watch in terms of their body language and so forth. Again, is all designed in part to present a most positive image in front of the people. Some of your consultants as well may rely heavily on the use of focus groups. And let me just talk to you a minute about focus groups and what they're designed to do. A focus group is a small set of individuals who are selected to come together, come to a gathering place and maybe, for example, hear a candidate's message or perhaps be shown certain TV advertisements for that candidate. And each focus group meeting may have be comprised of a similar group of people, makeup of people, such, for example, college-educated people, those who have no college degree, things like that. But what they'll do is that when the focus group assembles together, they're going to watch a speech or a TV spot, and they'll provide feedback to the consultant about what they liked and what they did not like about the candidate's speech. And they've even had this technology where you can actually hook you up to a computer, or you have a little dial-in for a computer, and you can respond immediately by providing feedback regarding what parts of a candidate's speech played the best with you. So if the candidate is talking about, for example, if there's a focus group going on with college students, the candidate is talking about, for example, subsidizing college loans, maybe the students will register a more favorable rating. If the candidate talks about maybe, increasing our military involvement overseas, maybe the overall collective response will go down. But in any case, what this allows a consultant and a candidate to do is to find out what particular aspects of a TV spot or what particular points in a speech seem to play best with a given demographic. So again, we're talking about sort of the art and even to some degree the science of image making. When a candidate wins the office, if the candidate is successful, a lot of these political consultants will then end up getting top jobs in the president's administration. Again, this is part of the idea of the spoil system. Those who help you get elected, those loyalists will be the ones who will get some of the top jobs and comprise maybe your White House office staff. And so these are, again, some of the ideas in which you see how the nature of campaigning has really significantly changed over the years. And again, one of the things I will really particularly emphasize is, again, the use of the internet. I remember when Hillary Clinton was running for president, she launched an internet website with a video talking about her launch for office. Certainly Barack Obama in the 2008 election, John McCain, both had websites that were very useful for people who wanted to give small donations through credit card. And that was a very effective way by which the candidates were able to raise money. Now, speaking about presidential campaigns, then let me talk a little bit about this. What do presidential candidates need to do in order to win the presidency? Well, obviously raise money, and that's certainly part of that. But specific campaign strategies I want to talk about just for a minute here. The first thing if I were consulting a campaign, being a consultant, serving as a consultant on a presidential campaign, one of the first things I would obviously tell the candidate, if they didn't already know this, was that they really need to run to the middle. See, what happens here, especially in terms of the general election and the primary system, and we'll talk about more of this later too, but presidential candidates are selected, they're nominated by their parties through the primary process, and these are elections that take place all across the country where the party faithful choose their nominee. And in order to win the primary, the candidate has to appeal to the true believers. Because you think about who's going to be coming out in the primaries, those are going to be the true believers. And so they've got to create their message in a way that appeals most to those individuals who are coming out and turning out to vote in those primaries. The problem about that is that the people who turn out in the primary elections, who vote in the primaries, are not that similar to the average American. In fact, they tend to be more ideologically oriented. So what happens here is that a presidential candidate who wins the primaries could be seen by most Americans as being very too extremist for their views. In other words, for their taste. So you could have one candidate who's too far to the left or one too far to the right. And the point here is that because of that, once you win the primaries, you need to run to the middle as fast as you can. And one of the things, I'll talk about Bill Clinton here for a minute. A lot of people give him credit in terms of his campaign strategies because they said he was easily able, on the one hand, to appeal to the true believers in the Democratic primary, but at the same time appeal to the middle road of America. He would say things like, focus on family values and personal responsibility, and a quote was to end welfare as we know it. And so a lot of these kinds of things that he said were designed to attract a broad range of people in the middle. This is what we were talking about in our last segment on political parties, about the fact that so many of the voters are actually in the middle and moderate, not on either extreme of the ideological spectrum. So candidates are aware of this, and they need to run to the middle. They need to moderate their message to appeal to that wide range of voters that are out there in the middle. So that's one of the things that they need to do. A lot at the same time, related to this, they need to preserve their base while trying to win over those middle people. So on the one hand, it's the same kind of balancing act that the parties have to play and have to pay attention to. You want to be able to win over those moderate voters, but at the same time, not so much that you end up alienating your true believers, the more extremist in terms of both camps. So you need to make sure that you are able to kind of curry favor with both sets of people, the moderate middle American voters, as well as the true believers who turn out to vote in the primaries. That can be a real tough balancing act. You don't want to come across as being so watered down that your true believers will say, there's no way I'm going to vote for this candidate because this candidate no longer really represents my values. So you got to be very, very careful about that. If you cater too much to those true believers, however, your opponent is all too happy to say that you are out of touch with mainstream America. So again, it is a bit of a balancing act. You also want to make sure, as part of your strategies, that you want to focus on campaigning in those states that have the most payoff. And when I say payoff, I'm talking about in terms of votes and therefore specifically electoral college votes. We'll be talking about the Electoral College a little bit later on, but basically the idea is that the states that have the largest number of electoral votes are the ones that you need to focus on. Once you have won your party's nomination, you want to spend most of your time campaigning essentially in larger states where you know that you have a huge number of electoral votes and where you know you have a chance. California, for example, would be a good place to spend a lot of time and effort campaigning as long as you know you have a chance to win the state of California. Another example might be Florida. You don't want to waste your time and money campaigning and running TV ads in places like Rhode Island or New Jersey or Delaware because they don't really have a whole lot of electoral votes to give. And just to give you an example of this, in the 2008 election, both Barack Obama and John McCain made literally hundreds of trips back and forth to California as well as to Florida because those were two critical states for both candidates. So that's an important strategy as well to think about. Now, as part of campaigning is concerned, and this actually applies not only to presidential candidates, but to all candidates, of course, what we see over and over again, all the way up until the election, we become saturated with television advertisements, and they often tend to be very negative in nature. Instead of a campaign advertisement that talks about what a great candidate a person is, instead, you'll often hear negative ads about the opponent. Now, negative campaigning is certainly not something new. It's been around for hundreds of, since the founding of our country. But it seems to me that a lot of people have been turned off by negative campaigning. You see a lot of mudslinging, a lot of distortions of each candidate's records. And these are particularly reflected in these political advertisements. But remember, the purpose of the political advertisements is not to tell the truth, per se, but instead, is to sell a product. They want to sell their product as their candidate. And if that means attacking the other candidate, that's what they're going to do. So let's just give you a few examples of this. Let's go back to 2004. If you remember in 2004, George W. Bush was running for re-election against John Kerry. We see George W. Bush create advertisements that create John Kerry as a flip-flopper. You may remember seeing these. I mean, some of these really just are burned in my mind, where he's flipping back and forth, flip-flopping back and forth in terms of his positions. And then again, these are the kinds of things that stick with the voters. There's also allegations that perhaps John Kerry was not being truthful about his service record in Vietnam when he was a soldier in Vietnam. There were also, at the same time, ads against George Bush that suggested that the White House was for sale by corporate giants such as Enron. And so, again, that basically George Bush was in the pocket of a lot of these corporate entities. We see, I'll go back a few years before that, in 1996, we see Bill Clinton running for re-election against Bob Dole, former Republican senator from Kansas and former House Senate Majority Leader. We see ads that were aired by the Dole campaign that show Clinton talking to young people on MTV about smoking marijuana. And one of the questions that came up was something related to something that Bill Clinton had said about, yes, I had tried marijuana, but I didn't inhale. And one of the members of the audience in this MTV ad basically asked Bill Clinton, they said, well, if you had a chance to do it again, would you inhale? And he kind of joked about it and kind of shook his head somewhat affirmatively. And the idea behind this is that the Dole campaign strategist took this segment off of MTV and made it part of the Dole campaign ads to depict or question Clinton's character. Is he a president you really could trust? Most recently, in the race between Barack Obama and John McCain, we remember hearing in campaign speeches and advertisement that Obama likes to pal around with terrorists. And other groups were depicting, for example, Obama as being a Muslim, and even though he has stated quite clearly he was not a Muslim. So again, you see a ways in which, the idea was to advance your candidate by attacking the character or integrity of the opponent. Now, the question is this: why do we see so many negative campaign ads? If we don't like them, then why do we keep seeing them 24/7, especially with the few weeks before the election? Why do we tend to see all these campaign ads running that have such a negative tone? Well, the reason why is because they are effective. Now, who do they reach? Whom do they reach? Who's likely to be the most influenced by these advertisements? And that is basically those who have yet to make up their minds. Those who are clearly made those decisions that they're going to vote for one candidate or the other are pretty much not going to be influenced by these negative advertisements, except to make them to reinforce their positions against their opponent even more with the idea of selective exposure operating that we've talked about before. But by and large, though, those who have yet to make up their minds are those who are most likely to be influenced by the advertisements. And you can actually see a correlation in terms of that. If there are the greater the percentage of undecided voters in a campaign, the more likely you're going to see negative advertisements designed to influence those individuals. Now, we should also talk a little bit about, not only in terms of campaign strategies and the nature of how campaigns changed, but we should also look about more specifically to the topic of campaign financing. Because campaign financing is, campaigns are a big business. It takes a lot of money to run a political campaign, not only at the presidential level, but also at lower levels as well. So I want to talk a little bit about campaign financing. For example, in 2008, the average cost to run for the House of Representatives was roughly $1.3 million. If you were running for the Senate, the average cost to run a Senate campaign was $7.1 million. Now, some of the Senate campaigns were in the $23, $24, $25 million that were spent, but the average cost was about $7.1 million. There are a lot of websites. For example, the Federal Election Commission has a website, www.fec.gov, that has information about campaign contributions. Another interesting website is something called opensecrets.org. There are a lot of interesting kinds of information that you can pull out from these websites that talk a little bit, that show you the flow of money into these campaigns. 2008 was a very, very expensive campaign year, and as goes on record, every single new year we have in terms of campaigns, they become the record year because they increase every year, it seems like. But even go back a little bit. 2004, Kit Bond, Senator from Missouri, he raised a total of $8.9 million, spent about that amount as well. 2006, Claire McCaskill is running for the Senate. She raised and spent approximately $11.4 million. Her opponent, Jim Talent, the Republican incumbent, raised $23.7 million. Interestingly, he lost that election. But again, a lot of money here, what we're talking about here in Missouri. In the 7th District in the Springfield area, covered by the 7th District for the House of Representatives, Roy Blunt received, in 2008, 68% of the vote. He raised about and spent about $2.6 million. And as I have indicated before, in the 7th District of Missouri, it's a very, very conservative district. you don't really need to spend $2.6 million in order to win. Now, a lot of that money he actually spread around to other candidates in other districts that were tighter elections, but nonetheless, he was able to raise about $2.6 million. And he was among, Roy Blunt was among the top in terms of recipients of PAC money, Political Action Committee money. And we're going to be talking about PACs in a little bit more detail in just a few minutes here and their roles that PACs play. But interestingly, Roy Blunt's Democratic opponent raised only $61,000. So you've got $2.6 million versus $61,000. Interestingly, in this particular election, his opponent still managed to get 28% of the vote. But I think in part that was a bit of a what you would call a coattail effect from the campaign of Barack Obama. In 2008, Barack Obama, speaking of Barack Obama, he spent about $730 million from all sources. The largest majority was about $650 million that was raised in individual contributions largely through the internet. Again, that's why I was telling you how the internet has become so important in terms of the campaign role of campaign finance. John McCain spent about $333 million from all sources. So Barack Obama had twice as much money to spend. The largest majority of money for John McCain was $200 million or so in individual contributions, and he also had received $84 million in federal funding. Barack Obama did not take federal funding this time because when you take federal funding, we'll talk about this again a little bit later too, when you decide to adopt or accept federal funding, then you also have to, that restricts and curtails your ability to raise funds outside that process. And Barack Obama was so effective at raising money, $730 million, that was a record-shattering amount of money, he obviously by accepting federal funds, that would have actually hurt his campaign. John McCain decided to abide by that because when John McCain was first running for president in the primary system, he ran out of money pretty quickly, and that was seen as a good thing. But unfortunately, I think that also hamstrung him in terms of his ability to raise more money overall during the general election against Barack Obama. But even all this money that we're talking about, $730 million, $333 million on McCain's part, all of that does not reveal even the entire picture. Even more money, more millions of dollars were actually spent by supporters who operate outside of that system. Now, I want to tell you a little bit about campaign finance reform and talk about why it's difficult to achieve. First of all, I want you to think about this. Campaign finance reform, as much as everyone agrees that we've got too much money in the system, and what we're concerned about is, does that money buy unfair access to certain people? In other words, if I've got a lot of money to contribute, does that give me an unfair access to the candidate? Are the candidates either be members of Congress or the president, does that mean they're going to make decisions that reflect my interest unfairly because of my influence that I have in terms of contributing their campaigns? If I'm an organization and I create a political action committee to raise money for candidates, you know, does that PAC contribution give that PAC unfair access to a member of Congress? And of course, that's what the concern is. But the key here is that even though we all agree that campaign finance reform, I mean, the campaign finance is very, very high, it's hard to achieve reform. And in part, and this is what I want you to think about the reason why it's hard to achieve. Largely, the people who are in power right now who have been successful in raising these large amounts of money in Congress or in the president, they benefit from the system the way it's currently constructed. In a lot of ways, and think about this in terms of Congress, in a lot of ways, for members of Congress to achieve true reform in campaign finance, what they're basically doing is creating a different set of rules that would then potentially work to their disadvantage in terms of getting reelected. They are there, they get elected and reelected in part because they have benefited from the way the system is currently structured. So why would you want to change that system that might potentially undermine your efforts to get reelected? So there's a motive in place. I mean, the ones who are there now because of the way the current system is structured. Why change those rules? And that's why for many years, it was hard to get any real progress done in campaign finance reform. And even the reform that there has been some significant reform that's taken place, but the question is how significant has it been in terms of changing or altering the flow of money. So one of the points I want you to understand is that campaign finance reform is difficult to achieve simply because of the way the motives that are at work here and the dynamics. And those who are in power right now are in power because they have benefited from the current system. So why change the nature of that system? But the other thing I wanted to suggest to you here that makes it difficult in terms of campaign finance reform is that even if you do enact certain reforms, the whole campaign finance system, in a lot of ways, is like Swiss cheese. I think of either Swiss cheese or there's a game at Chuck E. Cheese, Whack-A-Mole. And if you may know that game where, you know, the mole comes up in a hole and you try to whack it, and then it comes up into the hole and you try to whack it. So you can either call this a whack-a-mole theory of campaign finance or the Swiss cheese theory. It's the same idea. There are plenty of holes in the system. And if you try to plug up one hole, what happens is that the money finds its way into another hole, and people take advantage and exploit that other hole. So the money really doesn't go away. It simply pops up in one hole or the other. And we're going to be talking about that down the road. But let me also tell you this ahead of time, too. One of those significant holes has been reinforced by the Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court says this is a permanent hole in the system that we're going to allow because it's constitutional. So in a lot of ways, you've got these holes in the system where the money can come through, and the Supreme Court has said in a very, very famous court case, which I'll go ahead and tell you, is Buckley versus Vallejo in 1976, which basically says that it institutionalized the existence of one of these holes because they said this hole is legitimate, it's constitutional, it has to stay there. So, consequently, campaign finance reform is very difficult to achieve. All right, now let me to talk to you briefly about an overview of campaign finance reform. We're going to talk a little bit historical, important pieces of legislation that have taken place. We're going to talk about some fundamental longstanding problems and then recent attempts to address these problems here. Okay. First of all, if we go back in history, one of the first efforts to reform our campaign finance system was the passage in 1971 of the Federal Election Campaign Act, the FECA. And it's been amended several times since 1971 as well. But basically, it was designed to provide a level playing field for presidential candidates. It governs national campaigns, but it has some particular things to say about presidential elections. In terms of presidential elections, it was designed to provide a level playing field so that basically we have a fair race. And essentially, it tried to do three different things. The first major provision of the FECA was to prevent undue influence by any one individual donor by limiting individual contributions. It wanted to make sure, the FECA wanted to make sure that wealthy individuals, corporations, or interest groups could not simply buy a candidate. I mean, if I could give it directly $1 million to a presidential candidate, do you think I might want something for that in return? So again, it was trying to prevent some undue influence from taking place. A second provision of the FECA was designed to prevent large imbalances in the level of money that both candidates received. And they did this by setting up a system of public financing of presidential campaigns. Do you remember when you fill out your tax returns? The tax form says, do you want $3 of your taxes to go to the Presidential Election Campaign Fund? It's a pot of money that's created for both the Democratic and Republican nominees. In 2008, that pot of money was $84 million available for both candidates. So it's funded through a public system. In other words, your taxes are going to pay for these campaigns. And the idea here is this, is that it sets up a system of public financing, and the idea is that it provides a lot of money to create an incentive for people to take advantage of that. And if people take advantage of that, then they've got to play by certain rules, but it kind of levels out the playing field. And so ostensibly what people thought was going to happen in 2008 was that both candidates, the Democratic and Republican nominee, would both get about $84 million in federal funds to run their campaigns. And this would be helping them in both a general election and also in the state-by-state primaries. John McCain took advantage of this and received $84 million in federal funds. Barack Obama, as I mentioned, was doing so well at raising money outside that process that he chose not to limit himself to the $84 million, because that would obviously hamstring him in terms of other requirements and restrictions. So he did not accept that. And it'd be very interesting to see what happens in the next presidential election in 2012. Will the candidates bypass that system altogether? It'd be very interesting to see. But if they chose to accept federal funds, what that would basically mean is that this would limit the amount of money that candidates could spend out of their own pocket. Actually, only up to $50,000 is a candidate allowed to spend out of their own pocket once they accept federal funds. And so, again, and to qualify for federal funding, you have to be able to raise $5,000 in 20 states for a total of $100,000 in order to qualify, minimal qualification requirements. But the point here is that for presidential candidates, the federal government helps to fund those campaigns, if they so choose. Interestingly, and again, the ideally to provide a level playing field. Interestingly, there is no federal funding for congressional campaigns. All of the money raised by congressional candidates have to come out of their own pockets or be raised by individuals, interest groups, and when I say interest groups, we're really talking about political action committees or the parties. Political parties provide money as well. Now, so that's one of the things that the FECA did with respect to presidential campaigns, was it set up this public financing system. In terms of other, not only presidential campaigns, but also congressional campaigns, the Federal Election Campaign Act also created a system to monitor campaign expenditures and contributions made by individuals. So it created something called the FEC, the Federal Election Commission, to monitor how much money comes into a candidate's race and how much money goes out. In other words, we're talking about candidates for Congress or also candidates for the presidency. The Federal Election Commission, as I mentioned, has a website, www.fec.gov, and you can see, for example, who from Springfield gave money during, for example, the most recent election, how much money they gave and who they gave their money to. Now, the campaign limits, I'm going to talk about some specific limits here about what people can provide. And in process of doing this, I'm also going to be showing you what the limits do and what the limits do not do, okay? In other words, I'm alluding a little bit to that hole in the Swiss cheese. But according to some of the most recent figures, and again, these will change over every election because they're indexed for inflation, no one individual can give more than $2,400 to any one candidate per election. So if you wanted to write a check to a person running for Congress, you can write a check for $2,400 to get to that campaign for them in both the primary and then another $2,400 in the general election if they win the primary. So you can give basically up to $4,800 in two separate checks to a member running for Congress. You can do the same thing for a member or for someone who's running for president. If you want to give money, for example, Ron Paul was running for president, you want to write $2,400 for his primary and $2,400 for the general election, you can do that. Now, you can also give up to $30,000 and $400 to a national party committee. So the Democratic National Committee, the Republican National Committee, you can give up to a little over $30,000 right now to that committee. A major consequence of the FECA was the rise of PACs. We've been talking about PACs a little bit. Let me make sure we understand what PACs really are. PACs, or political action committees, are organizations that are set up by a corporation, labor union, trade association, interest group, okay, groups like these, designed to raise money to support candidates or ideas. All right, so it's basically the fundraising arm, for example, of an interest group. The FECA, interestingly, said that corporations or labor unions could not give money directly to candidates, but they could give money indirectly through a PAC that was set up on their behalf. All right, so they could raise money in voluntary contributions from their members through a political action committee. Now, let me give you an example of how that might work. Let's say that I grew up in the South during a time when we saw the textile industry beginning to go in under a state of decline. Many years ago, with cotton in the South and so forth, textile industries and factories were all over the southern states. And even when I was growing up in my part of the country in South Carolina, we saw a lot of textile mills, a lot of cotton mills. But we have seen over time those mills begin to close down and ship jobs and lose those jobs because more and more people are buying their textiles from overseas where the unit costs, labor costs are much cheaper. So let's say, for example, that you happen to be the director of an industry like the textile industry. You may be a plant president, own a particular manufacturing facility. And let's say that you get together with other business leaders in the textile industry. Together, you may set up a political action committee designed to raise money and give that money to candidates who are for saving American jobs. There might be some candidates all across the country, not just in South Carolina, who have said that we want to basically put quotas on the importation of foreign textiles. All right, so we want to put quotas on the import of clothing. We want to focus more on buying American clothes. Then you're going to, as a textile pack, give money to those candidates. Another example would be automobile manufacturers. They may set up a pack to give money to candidates who favor restrictions on importing Japanese automobiles. Again, so this is the whole idea behind political action committees. Now, in terms of restrictions and requirements for PACs, you can give up to $5,000 to any one PAC in any one year. So if there are a lot of different PACs that are out there that you like and you've got the money to do it, you can write a check to this PAC and that PAC and you know as many PACs as you'd like. And what about in terms of the money that PACs collects? These PACs now, like this automobile manufacturing PAC, is collecting a lot of money from a lot of individuals all across the country. No PAC can give more than $5,000 directly to any one candidate per election. So again, $5,000 in the general election, $5,000 in the primary election. Okay, so as a PAC, I'm getting all this money from individuals and I'm now then funneling it to various candidates up to potentially $10,000 per candidate per, you know, the election cycle. $5,000 for the primary, $5,000 for the election, a general election. So I've got a lot of money coming in, I've got a lot of money going out. And again, I don't have to limit the money I'm giving to only candidates in, say, where the auto industry is located simply in Detroit or in Michigan or the textile industry. I mean, I can give money to candidates all across the country. If you think about this, you know, every 2 years, Congress goes up for election or re-election, the House of Representatives does. That's 435 members. And if I can find 435 people, either incumbents or challengers, who are willing to support my views, I will give 435, if I've got the money, 435 candidates times two for the primary and the general election, you know, potentially. That's a lot of money we're talking about. So those are some limitations here, but it still involves a lot of money. The thing that's interesting, and this is where I'm going to start going into that Swiss cheese hole here, all right? And this is, again, those limitations, in a lot of ways, are only the tip of the iceberg, because here is what a PAC can do beyond that. PACs can spend indirectly as much as they want on behalf of a candidate. There are no limits on indirect contributions and indirect expenditures. What I was talking about before, those $5,000 limitations, are direct expenditures where the PAC writes a check to, for example, Roy Blunt for re-election for Congress, all right? Roy Blunt for Senate. Now, those are the kinds of things where the PAC limitations come into play. But indirectly, a PAC could spend literally, theoretically, if they had the money, millions of dollars for as many candidates as it wanted to. This is where the rest of the iceberg begins to come into play, because the PACs can run ads for you, television advertisements for you, or against your opponent. They can send out letters on your behalf, to supporters or to attack opponents as well. They can send out letters to various groups, members of labor unions and so forth, and ask for them to support a particular candidate. So, not surprisingly, PAC spending plays a major role in Congress. If you are an incumbent, in fact, you tend to get more of your money from a PAC than if you are a challenger. If you're a challenger, in this case, you have to rely more upon individual contributions or in your own pocket. And chances are you'll end up raising a smaller amount of money than the incumbent. If you are not an incumbent, you have to put much more of your own money up, right? If you are an incumbent, you have a much easier time raising money. And this helps, by the way, to guarantee that incumbents tend to get reelected overwhelmingly in Congress. So I think about 94% of incumbents end up getting reelected. About 75% of all PAC dollars go to incumbents, and in part because of the fact that they are a known commodity. In other words, if you're an incumbent in Congress, you have a voting record, people know what you stand for, and that attracts more PAC support. The PACs can look at your voting record and say, oh, I see that this candidate really supports this legislation that was important to us in the past. We're going to continue to give money to this candidate because of that. So the incumbents attract overwhelmingly the lion's share of money from political action committees. But going back to the idea of this indirect money here as well, let me also make sure we understand this point. If a PAC basically comes up to me, I'm running for Congress, they write me a check, $5,000 for the primary, another check, $5,000 for the general election. I say, thank you very much. But the PAC likes me so much, they decide to run and spend literally hundreds of thousands of dollars on TV advertisements on my behalf. What they are doing basically is saying, we like you and want to do this. Now, they cannot, that is the PAC, cannot coordinate with the campaign of the candidate, with their staff or their media people that are part and are hired by the candidate. There cannot be any kind of direct coordination between the PAC and the campaign of the candidate and their staff. But as long as there's no coordination and the campaign, the PAC, between the PAC and the campaign, then that PAC can just spend as much money as they want. So if you happen to be a member of a PAC or the director of a PAC and you're spending a lot of money on my behalf, you know, you can do that, and I can't stop you know, or if you're trying to attack me, and I cannot stop you from doing that, because that is your right in part to do so as part of your right of political and free expression. This is the idea behind Buckley versus Vallejo in 1976 that ruled that this is the kind of indirect PAC contributions were constitutionally protected. We're going to talk about that in a little bit more detail in just a second here, but that's part of the hole in the Swiss cheese that I was talking about. Now, of course, while you're in office, let's say you get elected or reelected, while you're in office, you're going to be spending a lot of your time raising money for the next election. Congress, interestingly, because particularly the House of Representatives, because they serve every 2 years, they've got 2 years to prove themselves, and they're reelected or elected every 2 years. It's a two-year cycle in the House of Representatives. Congress has been known as a constant campaign because the minute you hit the ground running, and after you've won the election, you hit the ground running immediately for trying to amass funds for engaging in fundraising over the next 2 years to help finance your next election. You know, if you are an incumbent, then you actually have a lot easier time raising money, and that helps to guarantee that you'll be reelected. If you get 75% of all PAC dollars, and obviously your opponent has less than that, your challenger has a much more difficult time raising money. A lot of that has to come out much more out of their own pocket. And also, another important point we'll talk about when we discuss Congress as an institution is that over that two-year cycle, members of Congress have the opportunity to really become very visible to their constituents to show all the great things that they're doing. So these, in a lot of ways, stack the odds much more in favor of the incumbent. And that doesn't surprise me, therefore, why incumbents tend to get reelected overwhelmingly. And again, about 94% of people who are incumbents today in Congress were there because they were reelected. So the question here then is whether or not this money, this spend on campaigns, does spending make a difference? Does spending tip the balance? Well, spending certainly does not necessarily guarantee a win. Again, I think about the 2006 senatorial campaign and election between Claire McCaskill and Jim Talent. They both spent a lot of money. Claire McCaskill, around $11 million. Jim Talent, over twice that amount, $23 million. But Claire McCaskill won that election. But nonetheless, even though spending doesn't guarantee a win, often where it really can make a difference is when you have an open seat, when you have neither an incumbent, but you simply have, you don't have an incumbent, but instead two challengers. You have an open seat and potentially an unclear outcome, then certainly spending can easily tip the balance. Those who spent the most became the most visible, and that can, and more likely than not, guarantee their success in terms of winning the election. What we're going to do during our next segment is we're going to continue our discussion about campaign finance. We're going to talk about some of the effects of reform on campaign finance. We're talking about some of the problems that continue to plague the campaign finance system, some major milestones that occurred, and also some of the most recent developments in campaign finance. So we'll talk about this. Then we'll conclude with a discussion of perhaps how we should further reform our campaign finance system by discussing some of the various proposals. So until then, this is Patrick Scott for PLS 101. We'll see you next time. Thank you.